Kobiety Hollywoodu jeszcze raz będą i jeszcze drugi raz. Znaczy będzie jeszcze odcinek trzeci, będzie odcinek również czwarty. Uwaga, uwaga, już niedługo, już za momencik, koncert Eltona Johna, ale przedtem wywiad z Eltonem Johnem przeprowadzony przez Piotra Kaczkowskiego. Ja się od kogoś dowiedziałem, że podobno właśnie Elton John nosił tak czapkę. I tutaj dziwna rzecz, bo tak mi się wydaje, że dosyć dziwną funkcję pełnił tenże daszek, bo niby daszek jest po to, żeby zasłaniać oczy, a tutaj tak jakby troszeczkę uszy. Ale słuch przecież Elton John ma wspaniały i zaraz wszyscy się o tym przekonają, no ci, którzy nie znają Eltona Johna, myślę, że takich jest niewielu. Tak więc zapraszam na koncert Eltona Johna z Rio de Janeiro.
After all you've done, what's left to prove? This is a sentence that we keep hearing a lot.
Yeah. That's a good question. I think there are always new challenges. You know, musicians are always in search of the perfect show, the perfect gig, the perfect song, the perfect performance, the perfect record. Like a painter's in search of a perfect painting. And you think you've achieved that and you're very happy with it, and then when you listen to your work in 2 years' time, in retrospect, you know that you haven't, maybe. And so you keep going in that pursuit of the holy grail of music, whatever it is that makes you happy. And I think that's the drug that music is. You know, you're always in search of something better, which is a nice thing to have in your life if you've always got a challenge. It would be horrible for me to be sitting here talking to you saying there's nothing left for me to do, because then what could I do? I think I have the best band that I've got on the road now with me that I've ever had, and I've had some terrific bands, and I think I have a lot of music left in me. I'm 48 years old, yeah, and that's quite old as far as a rock and roll business goes, but I see myself more as a musician now than a rock and roll musician. You know, that's for the younger people. I mean, we still play an element of rock and roll in our show, but my tastes change, and I have many challenges in my life to look forward to. Without love,
surrounded by love, people love you, audience loves you, radio presenters love you. How can you cope with it?
It's difficult for me. I'm not very good at accepting love. I'm very good at giving love. All my life I've been very kind of, I've always given love, because maybe I didn't receive that amount of love, physical love, when I was a child. So I'm very good at giving love, and I'm not very good at receiving it. I'm trying to get better, and I am getting better. And it's one of the things that I've learned to do since I've been sober. Is to try and change that. It doesn't change overnight. It's something you have to practice. I mean, I've spent 43 years of my life one way, and now in the last 5 years I'm trying to change that. So gradually I'm changing. But it's not easy. I'm used to being one person, and I'm trying to now be a better person. It's another good challenge to have, to try and change, to admit your mistakes, to try and see and change for the rest of your life the things that were wrong in the first part.
Comparing to the day when you were walking down St. Mark's Place, going to Fillmore East with Bernie.
Yeah.
Is it different now? Then you were going, like, unnoticed.
I think it is, in a way. I mean, when you first go to those places, when you first begin to make it, when you first go to America, when your first record is released, it's so exciting. I mean, those are the days that you never forget. These days, you know, it's changed. But I'd still, you know, the thing that hasn't changed for me is that I still love to buy records or CDs or cassettes or whatever it is now. And I'm still enthusiastic about listening to things, and I still love, it's like a drug for me, this music. But yeah, I think there's a certain energy you get at my age that you don't get when you're younger. When you're young, it's a different sort of energy, and everything is exciting. Now, because I've seen so much, only certain things are exciting. So, you know, you do change.
Feeling inside, I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling shoe. There's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, yeah, I just want to give. You can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful I am for your
You mentioned once that Daniel, or your song, would be like your contribution to the world music. That was years ago. Do you think there is more?
I think we've written some songs that stand the test of time. I mean, if you make an album and on each album there's one song that you continue to like playing, then that's a good achievement. I think songs like Come Down in Time, which we're doing on this show, which I haven't done for a long time, The One, off the new album, there's a song called House, which I adore. Yeah, I mean, it's difficult for me to criticize my own work because I don't really listen to it. But, you know, they still sound good to me when we play them, so they must be good songs.
The life of a troubadour, you have so many homes.
Yeah.
Do you have one the home?
I suppose my spiritual home is in England because that's where I'm from, and I love my house in Windsor. But I have an apartment in America which I love. I like all my homes. They're all different. My home in America is very modern, a lot of black and white photography. My home in Windsor is very comfortable and very just like an English country house. And my home in London is different again. I'm like a gypsy. People on the road, I mean, you get homesick. But it's you know, if you're a musician, that's what you have to do. You have to go and play to people. You can't stay at home and play to people. You have to go out on the road. But I suppose my spiritual home would be in England.
Father, how to love me, mother, I had a little rhythm.
You're grown up now.
Trying to.
Do you still have advisors? You have advisors on clothes. Do you have advisors on music?
No, I don't have it. Well, when I say I have advisors on clothes, if Gianni Versace makes me an outfit, I let him do it. Because he's, you know, he's his own man and he's a designing genius. If someone, you know, like my musicians want to do something, like the intro to the show, they do that. I let them have their freedom. If you're creative, you should give people freedom. I think it's good if you make a record to have a producer that can sometimes say to you, maybe if you change this, it will be a better song. And I've always had producers like Gus Dudgeon and Chris Thomas and Greg Penny to tell me things like that. It's not easy to hear, because when you first write a song, it's very precious to you. And if someone says, I think the song could be better if you change something, your initial reaction is, no. But I know to trust these people that 99% of the time when people have actually said change this, they've been right, and they've only done it for the best reason. And they've all been musical people, and I think you have to listen to other people, because sometimes you're so self-obsessed and so self-absorbed with what you're doing, you can't see the wood for the trees, and so you need to have advice sometimes. Yeah,
the albums are always so well crafted. You say you've made 20 recordings for the last album. You used 11.
Yeah,
the rejects. Are you coming back to them later?
There's one song called Live Like Horses that sometimes we do on stage, which we tried to record. It's a very, very, it's a long song, and it was difficult to record. And it was the same length as Belfast, and I didn't want two very long songs on the album. We'll come back to that song. That's the only one we'll come back to.
And instrumental music, yeah. Song for Guy, yeah. Funeral for a Friend. Were you ever thinking of instrumental album?
Always, but I never seem to have the time to do it, because there's always, for example, the Duets album was completely off the cuff. What happened with that was that my record company said, we want to release an album of old duets for Christmas. And I said, I don't want any old duets. I'll go and record in 6 weeks an album of new duets, because I don't want my fans to buy the same stuff all the time. So it would be nice to do the instrumental album like that. It's just finding the time. I think as you get older, you know, and you do different things, like I've done the thing for The Lion King, I'm writing a stage musical. That will come eventually. I have plenty of time.
December 86, after your Sydney show, you went for operation, vocal calls.
Yeah.
Were you then thinking of instrumental if the operation
was
not successful?
I think I would have to be. I was scared, and my voice has changed because of that operation. It's a deeper voice, which I prefer. It means that some of the falsetto notes that I used to get, I can't get. But most of the songs we do are in the same key as the originals. It's just that it's given me a little bit of a depth to my voice. If I lost the use of my voice, I could always play the piano. As long as I have music in mind, I think never mind.
Thank you.
looking at the last 25 years, are you glad you are not a part of King Crimson?
Why do you say that?
Why? You were trying to be...
Oh, I know, King Crimson. I mean, yeah, it's hard to be a part of a group. You know, when you're a band, it's much better to be a solo artist for me and have musicians around you than being a group, because there's so many egos involved and so many... It's hard to survive in a group. Groups that survive, like the Floyd, and they've had their members who've left, and the Stones, and the Beach Boys that are still around after a long time. It's hard. I really admire people that stay together. Sometimes you have to have that antagonism to stay together. But I'm glad I'm not in a group, yeah.
Do you somehow have contact with people like Long John Baldry?
Long John Baldry lives in Vancouver, I think, and I see him, well, last time I saw him must be 10 years ago. So I don't. I think Rod sometimes hears from him, Rod Stewart.
The one with Rod Stewart?
We were going to be called Hair, Nose and Teeth. And that was Rod, who was going to be the nose, me was going to be the hair, or lack of it, and Freddie Mercury was going to be the teeth. And we thought of forming a supergroup, but it never happened, obviously. But it was going to be fun.
Can you recall your friendship with John Lennon?
It was for about a year. I met John through a friend of mine, and I appeared on Walls and Bridges and did two tracks. And then I said, listen, if this record gets to number one, which was Whatever Gets You Through the Night, will you please do a gig? And he hadn't done a gig for years. And he kept his word and came on at Madison Square Garden, and we did three songs together. I only had a year of seeing him off and on, and he really made an impression on me because of his generosity of spirit, his genius, and his humour, and his kindness. He was very kind. I was very scared of him because I thought he was a vicious person. He had a vicious wit, but he wasn't a vicious person.
Don't wish it away, don't look at it like it's forever. Between you and me, I could honestly say that things can only get better.
Who would you like to be involved with in a musical project with?
There's still so many people that I haven't worked with that I really admire, like, say, Joni Mitchell or someone like that. I like to work with new people too. I mean, I think Jeff Buckley is brilliant. I like to think Michael Stipe is brilliant. I love R.E.M. I like bands like Blur, who've got a lot of energy, but I think, you know, doing something with them would probably be out of the question because they have their own thing. But there are lots of great musicians around that you would like to work with, lots of singers you'd like to sing with, people who have beautiful voices like Toni Braxton. You know, there's plenty of people. Even Whitney Houston, people say Whitney Houston, but you know, when you hear her sing live, she's beautiful, it's a great instrument. So, you know, there are plenty of avenues left for me that there's still always musicians you want to work with.
That you used to buy every single record being released and listen to it.
I more or less still do.
Yeah. You still do?
Yeah, on CD. Yeah.
Who do you like now?
Who do I like now?
If you have time, who do you listen to?
I listen to a lot of classical records. When I get up in the morning, I listen to usually a dance compilation album when I'm shaving. I like things like Tricky. There's a girl now called Caroline Neville, which is beautiful. I love Brownstone. I listen to a lot of classical records sometimes, if you're in the mood. I like things like Tom Petty. It's very wide what I like. David Sanborn's new album, Pearls, which is beautiful. Whenever someone asks me, I can never think of them. But no, I listen to a lot, and Blur, I still love their last album. So there's a lot of things I like.
You had the historic first time signing of your records not so long ago.
Yeah.
Why did you wait so long?
Don't know. I that happened in Los Angeles, never done that before. Don't know, no one's ever really asked. Then I did another one in Paris, I did two in 2 weeks.
So how did you feel about that?
It was good, it was fun. But it took a long time. We were there from 11:30 till 3:45. But you can't not, if people are going to queue up, you must do everyone.
From the day we arrive on the planet and blinking step into the sun, there's more to be seen than can never be seen, more to do than can never be done. All beaten, some say, live and let live. But all are agree, and they join the stampede. You should never take more than you give in the circle of life.
You must remember your concerts in Poland 11 years ago.
Of course.
Do you have some recollections? Did you follow Poland in those 11 years somehow?
Oh yeah, of course. I mean, so much has changed. I mean, I still have on my desk in my library the picture of me with Lech Walesa and the concert at Gdansk, which was incredible. I mean, I'll never forget that ever. Seeing the whole people just, you know, and Lech coming towards the stage and standing there for the whole show, just at the front of the stage, and I'm thinking, this is a very surreal experience. I've just had tea in his apartment and here he is right in front of me. And I remember it was snowing when we went to the plane, and the thing, you know, the simple myths you get in the West, that there was no food, and, you know, take something with you to Poland, there's no food, and we ate more in Poland than we did anywhere else. So, you know, a lot of things have changed in the 11 years since I've been here, obviously. I mean, I went to Russia last week and so much has changed there. On a flying visit like this, you're not going to see for yourself, but, you know, obviously there'll be other times to see that. We'll be right back. I'd just like to say how great it is to be back in Poland, and we have very fond memories of our last trip here, and hopefully we'll be back to play in other places. It's just nice to be able to come here without the hassle that we had last time.